He is an assistant professor from Christ University, Bangalore, and he has mastered and specialized in international relationships. His topic is going to be on impact of COVID-19 on international relationships. So over to you, Dr. Anurag Tripathi, sir. Am I audible to you?
Yeah, sir.
Welcome.
Am I audible? Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Clear and sound.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Mahatma Gandhi College and principal Mahatma Gandhi College for inviting me on this particular topic on impact on COVID-19 on international relation. As a previous speaker already mentioned that each and every discipline directly or indirectly somehow connected with this particular problem which across the globe is facing. Similar thing is with the international relation also. Once this whole COVID-19 pandemic came and WHO basically announced that it is a global pandemic and we have to be alert with this particular virus, then there is a huge amount of debate started across the circle, across international circle. What will be the future? What will be the future of international relation? What will be the future of international system? How international world order will work? All these major questions actually started floating around in international circle. Two major important questions which we have to highlight. Does global pandemic change the nature of international affairs? Are the whole cooperation which is going on in international scenario that will be disturbed? Are each and every nation is going to be disconnected to each other? All these three important questions are there. First important question is whether nature of international affairs will be changed. Second, the cooperation which is existing in international order that will be disrupted, are the they are going with complete disconnection. All these issues are there when we are basically discussing COVID-19 and its effect or impact on international relation. I want to quote one important personality. His name is Paul Kennedy. And in the 80s, 90s, he wrote a book named Rise and Fall of Great Power. And he used two important terminology. One is the military power and another one is economic power. And he said that if any particular country want to survive in international order, they have to achieve these components. One is basically economic power, other one is military power. And he gave the examples during the time of First World War, how basically United Kingdom became powerful and later United Kingdom downfall. And after the Second World War, two major powers came, that is United States and USSR. And then after the Cold War, how United States became powerful. And 21st century, you can see how China is growing. So that's why he said that it is important if you want to become a powerful in international order, two things are very much important. One, you have to achieve economic power. Another one is a military power. Today, I want to change it a little bit because in 4 months, the whole world is looking something very different. They have one important point, that is a COVID-19. If you go to the new channel, whether it is a national new channel or international new channel, everywhere 95% news are covered by the COVID-19 problem. And that is going to be really alarming situation for us, that how one virus changed the whole phenomena, whole narration of world politics, obviously. And that's why Paul Kennedy, what he talked to things, that military and economic power both are necessary. What I am thinking, that another important component, how the states will deal with this particular virus. That is a more important to survive in international order. If they will use their techniques properly, if they will use to come with this particular problem in proper way, then obviously they will survive in a very effective way. As you see that economy is going to completely changed. politics is going to be completely, society is going to be changed. And if governments across the world, if they are not tackling this problem, then it is going to be disaster for any country, whether it is a great power, regional power, or any particular developing country. That's why the survival is very important question here. Before going to the impact, I want to discuss a little bit about the international system, how international system works, and what are the approaches are there which basically design the international system. There is two school of thought is there. One is realist school of thought, and other one is a liberal school of thought. Realists are saying that international system is an anarchic in nature and conflictual. It is a conflictual. Everyone is insecure about others. They are not rely on others because state are like that. State wants to achieve the interest and they want to become powerful. And they are not bothered about others. That is an international phenomena, because international phenomena is a very realistic phenomena, because it is not domestic structure where we have a proper government, proper bureaucracy, proper police system. That is not in the case of international politics, because there is no government as such in international politics. And that's why it is designed by the power and interest. Always each and every state is focused on their own interest, how to come with their own interest. That's why conflict always prevail in international society. And why conflict? Because everyone is insecure in international system, because they don't know what is the behavior of others. You can see that in the pandemic situation, how China is reacting in South China Sea, how China is reacting in Indian border, how Pakistan is infiltrating. Still, we both the countries are facing the COVID-19 problem, but still militants are infiltrating from Pakistan to India. These are the major question. That's why survival and the realistic approach is still, I think, very relevant in this regard also. Once COVID-19 will gone also, that realist theory always prevails, and everyone is focusing on their own interest. Second important thing, but one important phenomena which came in international order that changed the whole scenario, that is a liberal phenomena. That said, that no, what realist is saying that there is cooperation is missing, always conflict and war situation. No, cooperation is a possible. And you can see how China as a communist country opted free market economy. Because no one can understand that one communist country and talking about the liberal economy under the leadership of Deng Xiaoping, they opted the liberal ideology and they opted the free market economy. Why this is so? Because one argument is very much clear. No state in international system is a perfect. No particular state is a perfect in international system, and that's why cooperation is very much required. Maybe someone is powerful in military, someone is powerful in economics, someone is powerful in their technology, someone is powerful in their resources, but no one is perfect completely in all dimensions, and that's why cooperation is very much must. When we are talking about the international system in COVID-19 situation, you can see, though it started from China, but China tackled in a better way. Still, we don't have a proper idea that what is the situation in China, because most of the times, a lot of news reports are coming that no, China is still facing severe problem with the COVID-19. The people in academic circle who all are working in China and Shanghai University, my one friend who is working there as assistant professor, he told me, no, it is now fine situation here. So now you can see when Spain and Italy, France, all these countries started facing problem, China started giving proper equipment like N95 mask, PPT kit and all other things. That is a cooperation which is basically important in international system. Not always conflict, not always talking about the interest, not always going towards the power these are not going, because if you want to save the humanity, it is very necessary that you have to go with the cooperation mechanism. And that is a demand of the day, rather than going with a small problem, small international issues. We have to focus, we have to think now regarding the humanity, regarding the civilization. And that's why it is important to discuss that what will be the future of international politics after COVID-19. If we are not going in cooperation mode, we are in conflict mode, then it is a question mark on civilization, human civilization. So that is one thing which is very much required. And my take from narration of COVID-19 after international politics since COVID-19 is cooperation. Cooperation mechanism is very much required. Though blame game is going on across the world, you can see across the globe, each and every countries are. You can see blaming others, not someone saying that because of this particular state, it is basically spreading. Someone is saying this country is not tackling properly. Someone is saying WHO has a problem. They are linked with the, they are not announced it in a proper time. All these questions are floating around in international politics. And that's why it is very much necessary to analyze that. I'm taking two important examples to understand the whole COVID-19 situation, and then I think we can do justice to the whole conference, which is basically focusing on how it will impact on international relations. First one is I'm taking the American case, because. The America, I will talk about the economic dimension after that. Then when we are talking about the American system, which is basically now too much in American first ideology, which is basically introduced by Trump. And this particular time, Americans blaming China and WHO, they are now they are coming out from the WHO. All these questions are obviously going to affect the international order. Another important thing, Chinese role. China is still, you can see, somehow combat the problem, but the role of China in South China Sea and with the India is showing that how much China is curious about the world politics and how much China wants to become a great power. So that's why realist argument is always going to prevail in international order. That is basically national interest and power. So there is no doubt if you are going with the realist mindset of obviously this is going to play important role. But this COVID-19 situation is going to change drastically international order. I'm taking two authors. First one is a Henry Kissinger, who is saying that in political scenario, nothing is going to change. America will be the superpower. China is growing power. A lot of regional powers are there. Somehow it will be the status quo mechanism. But one thing which is going to change, that is an economic depression. And this is going to be disaster. Henry Kissinger compared it with the great economic crisis of 1930s, 1929 and 30s. That is going to be disaster here more actually, because it is a completely lockdown situation. Everything is stopped. And now there is purchasing power parity. Maybe United States is giving huge amount of money to their people to purchase the things. But if you are talking about the global international order is going to face huge economic crisis, and that is going to be disastrous, what I'm thinking. And even what Henry Kissinger is also pointed out, that it is going to be disastrous than what we faced in 1929 and 30s. Another important thing what I want to focus here, that how it affects the global economy, because now people started questioning to the liberal order. You can see how in 1991, after the collapse of USSR, everyone said that now it is somehow liberal economy won over the socialist and communist ideology or communist economic system. But again, if COVID-19 will affect drastically the economies and states are not able to combat this problem properly, then it is going to be huge disaster. It is not only society will face the whole question, whole liberal order will be question mark, whole question of globalization will be question mark if this particular problem will not be tackled properly. Another important thing, disruption of global value chain, that is going to be changed. Because you can see that if you see the cross-border supply chain, China is the world's largest production base. Now it is going to be changed because a lot of investors, they are looking other state to invest. And the similar thing you can see how India, Indian Prime Minister also announced that this is an opportunity. We have to take it like opportunity and we have to attract the investors towards India. So that is also going to disruption of global value chain. That is going to be changed. And that is another important thing is going to happen in across the globe. Third important thing, what I observed, that restriction on people to people movement, that is going to be restricted. The whole aviation, whole tourism industry is going to be affected. And or you can say that in other words, that is going to be in huge crisis. These are the things which are going investment. All these things are going to change because of this COVID-19. If people to people contact will be restricted, you can imagine what will be the situation of international order. The huge amount of, if you see world tourism, approx 15% of world tourism industry in economy, world tourism industry share is approx 15%. That is going to be completely in crisis. And that's why you can see the economic term, especially in international economic term, it is going to be question mark, no doubt about this. And it is going to change the whole phenomena of international order. Another, when we are talking about in political terms also, under the leadership of Xi Jinping, how basically China came with the BRI concept, Belt Road Initiative, and they want to connect the world with the BRI concept. BRI is going to be question mark because now people are thinking not in terms of BRI, they are thinking in terms of as a doubt in nature about the China and how European countries and Americans are very vocal against the China in world scenario. That is going to be really going to be change in international order, that people will start thinking China in a very different way. That is going to happen. And another important thing which I want to discuss, the disparity to tackle this problem. Some countries, they are equipped with proper equipments, medical equipments, and they are using it properly. But a lot of countries in Latin America, in basically African country, in South Asia, there is a huge crisis in terms of resources. And you can see, I'm giving example, I'm from UP and from Allahabad. And recently I was going through with the news that my brother is doctor, and that's why he's regularly going to the to his hospital. It is a government hospital, and he's saying that in the villages in district level hospitals, there is no ICU units, there is no you can say proper facilities for the doctors. So that is going to be disaster. Actually, how disparity is there? Without the cooperation, we can't tackle this problem. And that's why what I understand, there is no doubt about this in economic terms, in business terminology, world is going to be changed drastically because some sectors like aviation sector, some sector like tourism sector, you can food industry across the globe is going to affect by this particular COVID-19 problem, and that will write the new economic phenomena in international order. There is no doubt about this, but I think it is the right time. We are going to face the global crisis. We have to save ourselves, and that is only possible if we are not thinking about the small thing, and we have to come with a cooperative manner, and we have to think in a global village sense, and then through the cooperation we can help to each other, and we can again sustain ourselves for the future. And this is the question of how to combat with this problem and save the civilization. It is not only one civilization, we have to save complete globe with this problem. That's why I am thinking that international leaders has to come with the in cooperative mood rather than going with the conflictual situation. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Yes, sir. Over to you. If questions are there, you can take the questions now. Am I audible? Yeah, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah. Sorry, real issues, sir.
yeah.
There are some technical issues. So it was, sir.
Yeah.
It was a beautiful talk.
Yeah.
And now we'll move to the question answer session.
Yeah.
Okay. Hmm. So my first question is, what is your view regarding India's international business relationships with China as compared to United States due to COVID-19 pandemic?
Okay, one thing, China is, if you, I'm first focusing on India-China relation in terms of economics. Yes, we have a very good relation, and in terms of economic relation, we are in world bilateral cooperation, we are in third country which have a good relation, and a huge amount of Chinese interdependence is there to India and Indian interdependence to China. So that's why I'm always saying that both the government knows this fact that it is not going to, if they will stop the trade, then it is not going to be problem for India, it is going to be problem for both India and China. So that's why what I am thinking that India and China is not going to be in any war mode. They will keep their economic relations, because they understand the economic situation in international economics, and they will definitely in cooperative mode. I'm taking one example, it will be clear. When Doklam issue came in 2016, lot of analysts, international analysts, are saying that it is going to be war, but lot of analysts they told that no, it is not possible. The reason, because the economic interdependence between both the country, and no country can take any particular measure to basically stop international economics. So that's why what I understand, the both the country, how they are talking about in border that war will happen, but nothing is going to happen. It is because of economic component, and in a globalized era, you can see no one going to subside the economics. So that's why it is going to happen. Second important thing is that regarding US, yes, you can see recently even Trump, President Trump wants India to basically a part of G7 summit also. So US is giving importance to India, and US is thinking in terms of possible partner in this Asia, India as a possible partner. So I'm thinking that it is through the COVID-19, the economic relation is not going to affect. Maybe because of economic downfall, it is going to be a problem. But both the countries, both the leaders are not going to basically stop the economic relation to each other. And for India, it is maybe opportunity also. If China investment will be decreased, then obviously India will get some amount of investment from other countries, especially from Europe.
Thank you very much, sir. My next question is, will the strengthening of Sino-Russian relations directly influence the liberal international order?
Sino-Russian relation, China-Russia relation. Okay, no, I don't think so. Because you can see China, very interestingly, these are two countries which came from communist background. Russia came of 1991, they collapsed the USSR and now they are also in a liberal path. China is following communist ideology, but the economic terms, they are more liberal than United States. So their market is more open. So that's why what I observe that it is not going to affect, because India is also following the liberal economy and people understand the demand of the day. And that's why they are not going to disrupt any economic engagement. Though there is a suspicion, there is no doubt about this. Doubt is there among the countries regarding investment, regarding BRI, regarding the intention of China, regarding the intention of Russia. But ultimately, what I am thinking in economic affairs, it is going on. That is not going to disrupt.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. The another question is, what should be our stand against China before financial losses happened due to COVID-19?
That is very difficult, because this demand already came from Europe. This demand already came from United States. Because a lot of countries, they are asking that if this pandemic came, it is because China is the main culprit. But in international affairs, when I started my speech, I told that it is an anarchic system. There is no government. There is no reliability. How can you say that this is going to, China is going to give output? No, it is not possible. I'm telling you, before COVID-19, China intervened in South China Sea, and the International Court of Justice gave their judgment that China is violating international norms, rules and norms. China said that, no, we are not. Because international politics is based on power politics. If you are powerful in international order, you will solve your problem. If you are not powerful, then no one is going to listen to you. So that is the main mechanism here. If China is survive as a great power, no one is going to ask, and China is not going to give any output. Because the simple answer is world is connected, and that's why it is spread all over the world. That is not Chinese fault. So that's why it is not going to happen. And even India can't question on this thing also. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. I would like to ask another question. Will China suffer international anger in future? And if yes, what would be the consequences?
Yes, that is very right question and very interesting question. China is going to suffer, what I am thinking, because there is a huge amount of insecurity, and you can say that people are basically doubtful about the Chinese role in international order. In before pandemic also, even intention of BRI, Belt Road Initiative also, people are, lot of nations, they are not clear about Chinese intention. And especially after COVID-19, there is a huge amount of debate going on. A lot of people are saying China is the reason behind this. China want to great power, and that's why it is, because that is artificial virus actually there across the world is facing. All these questions are coming obviously. I think China is, especially in investment, I already talked about in my presentation, how the chain is going to disrupt. Most of the you can say that production is happening from the China. Across the globe, companies are investing there. Now they will be in question. They are in very doubtful situation. They are now, they will be looking for any other option. Similar thing is with Europe also. Europeans, especially Germany. Germany was the great partner of China before COVID-19. But now they are very vocal against the China. So that is going to happen. Maybe China is segregated in international politics. That will be tried by the Western power, obviously. So that is, China somehow will be affected, what I am thinking also. And this is going to be a good question mark on Chinese future. No doubt about this.
Sir, another question is, why China won't let us know earlier? And is COVID-19 a biological disaster to destroy the world like in the Cold War did?
It is disastrous than Cold War. It is disastrous than World War. It is disastrous than any particular war. What I'm telling you, till now, 4 lakh people are died with this particular problem. That this is going to be no problem. Even recently, there is a New York Times report came where they talked about a lot of crisis in United States, and they compared it with 9/11 and other things. They are coming to the conclusion that this is going to be disastrous. So that there is no doubt about this. This is going to be disastrous. If it is artificial, then obviously this is going to be question mark on China. Why safety measures are not taken by China? Why WHO took time to announce this particular problem as a pandemic? Why what US is saying? Why China is WHO is biased with the China? Though this is another debate, I'm not going on that debate. But this question will obviously come, and that will be the future debate in international politics, obviously.
So another question is that, shall we boycott China? It's a very common tempo we are having.
No, it is not. It is not possible. It is not possible, because in economic terms, we are well connected. The trade, in terms of trade, we are largest. China is the largest Indian trade partner. We can't do. It is going to be reverse effect to us only. So that's why what I understand, India can't do this, and we don't have a capability to do this. Get my, we can't stop economic relations with the China. That is not possible. May be possible. We can take some benefit in investment and other places, but we can't stop the economic relations.
So some questions are from YouTube platform. The first question I would like to ask, what would be the effect on world when USA exit from WHO?
That is an important thing, important question actually. If you see the funding wise in all agencies, not only in basically WHO, United Nations, most of the agencies, 60% fundings are coming from United States only. And once funding will stop from United States, that is going to be problem, obviously, to running the soap for WHO. The WHO is basically, that's why in this time, in the time of pandemic, it is very strategically, the US basically came out from WHO, because ultimately United States has to support WHO for running the organization, and huge amount of money is coming from United States only. So obviously this is going to be problem for WHO for functioning. Maybe once this problem will solve, this whole negotiation will again start, and US will again come into the picture, and maybe US will demand from some drastic change in WHO mechanism. That will be possible. But for the time being, yes, it is a problem. It is WHO's functioning is question mark. Other state is helping WHO for functioning, but without United States, it is difficult. So maybe future some negotiation will come.
So another question is it a trade war or something other? Who has the upper hand, us or China? And who will pay for the pandemic losses?
Yeah, that is a major question. That pandemic losses, who will? That is not possible. I'm telling you, after the First World War, we face Spanish flu. I'm telling you, one Hindi writer is there, Hindi literature, Suryakant Tripathi Nirala. So I am from Allahabad. His home is near to me. And during that 1919 situation, actually, his whole family died. His whole family died. And even my grandfather and my father, my grandmother and father also told that during the time of 1918, it was a story. A lot of stories are there in Allahabad, that how many people died during that time. Who is the responsible for that? No one is responsible for that. Who is going to fill the loss? No one is going to fill the loss. It is not possible. It is not possible. Even for China also. If China accepted also that this is a problem for China, this came from China, it is intentionally did by China, then also who will be responsible? Because in a state system, you can think if some accident happened, okay, chief minister said that each and every people who are injured will get the 3 lakh, 4 lakh rupees. But in international system is a very different system. It is not run by any particular government. And that's why the whole question of losses is, I think, not that much relevant.
Sir, another question is, can India achieve veto power in United Nations in this COVID pandemic?
Possibilities are there if India tackle it properly, but I don't think so India is tackling it properly. Because in starting, we were thinking that it is tackled properly, but how we are facing the migrant laborers, and now it is increasing, and we are in fourth position after United States, Russia and Brazil. Now it is difficult because we are also not tackling it properly. Even our policy meetings has a lot of loopholes. When we didn't have cases, only 150 cases. I came from Bangalore when cases are 142. Then during that time, lockdown came. If policy makers has to decide that, okay, we have a very upper level who are coming from abroad, they are infected by this problem. And during that time, if they'll give space to these migrant laborers and understand the economy in proper way, giving 15 days time, and then impose the lockdown, then I think it is more effective. I don't know. I am not policy expert, so that's why I'm not saying too much about very clearly that. But what I observed that Australia, New Zealand, there's one article in Express Tribune I was reading day before yesterday, how Japan tackled, how they first analyzing the functioning of their economy, how their economy is functioning. They tackle in 8-10 days, they gave time to the people to settle down, and then they locked down the situation. So that may be because of that, the situation. So that's why it is very much necessary. How our political masters are taking decision, that will tell the future how India will survive in international order.
Thank you, sir. So another question is, you talk about the international interdependability for the businesses and all. Then what about the Atmanirbhar India, what our Prime Minister has appealed to us? So can we stand on ourselves through Atmanirbhar India?
Yes, when you are talking about Atmanirbhar India, that is possible in 1947 when Gandhi came with the idea that we can't go with the liberal path. We only follow socialist. We have to go with the mixed path. We have to focus on our small industries, agriculture and everything, and then going for the big industry. Now we are completely interdependent. We are, our software engineers are basically there in other countries. how can we most of the MNC who all are established in Gurgaon, who all are established in Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, Hyderabad, they all are international companies. If they will back out, what will be the Atmanirbhar? So that's why Atmanirbhar is, yeah, we have to tackle it in a very different way, that we have to focus on our small industry, again revive the industry. It's very late, obviously it is very late. Our small industries are gone because of the big industries. So now we are, because of the globalization, because of the capitalism, we are completely infected. Going again back to the Atmanirbhar, it is not possible. We are very much connected to the world order. So I don't think so. It is in slogan, it is fine. But I don't think when it is coming to the execution part, it is difficult. Though our Prime Minister is doing very nice, he is saying that it is possible. But I don't think, I have a little doubt on that, that we can survive in this particular scenario, because economics is saying something different. Very specialized knowledge is required for economics. So that's why only saying Atmanirbhar is not going to become Atmanirbhar. What?
Sir, there are many questions, sir, but I would like to ask one more question, or maximum two questions. Pandemic crisis is a silent World War III waged by China. What is your opinion?
That is a world war situation. No, I don't think so. World war is very different. This is not first time when we are facing pandemics. It is a lot of cases are there, and even when Spanish flu came, a huge amount of population died because this pandemic. I'm telling you, if you are talking to your parents, grandparents, they will tell you India in 40s, 50s and 60s. People are dying because of very, very small diseases. And you can see the villages is completely swiped out because of the problems. The pandemic is not new order for international community. Though for our generation, yes, it is a new. But you talk to your grandfather, he will tell you how basically because of small diseases, the complete villages are swiped out. So that is not, we can't compare it with the World War, but it is disastrous than World War. That is, there is no doubt about this. We can't use synonyms, but we can say that it is disastrous than basically World War.
Sir, I would like to ask last question. There actually, yeah, we have many questions for you.
Yeah,
we
yeah.
Have to sort it.
Yeah, no problem, sir.
I would like to ask last question. What program would be feasible for the rural development when you see it as an international thinker?
I'm thinking is still India's primary sector is in government has evolved. What Pandit Nehru started in first 5-year plan, second 5-year plan, to focus on our primary industry, primary sector, that is basically agriculture. I think we have to again rely on that primary industry. I am working with one project with the that group is from Italy, and I'm working on one project where the focus point of discussion is the democracy versus development, whether it is possible or not. With the democracy, development, that is, they both are complementing each other or not. In that case, I am looking to the village economy, and where I found out that especially the small primary sector industry like milk industry, agriculture, people are somehow detached with these primary sectors. I think government has to focus on this particular sector as an industry. They have to focus on, they have to rely on, they have to give farmer too much weightage, they have to develop the infrastructure, then obviously our Atmanirbhar things can come out. But without focusing on that, without developing proper infrastructure, without giving telling the people that okay, this is opportunity. If you work, you will survive with that. People are thinking that with the agriculture, we are not going to survive. That question, that insecurity, which is there in the people's mind. If government will tackle this problem in effective way and provide proper infrastructure, I think then it is possible to basically tackle. So I think primary sector has to be focused.
Thank you very much, sir. I think one thing I got you now from your talk that international things are quite different from our common mindset. We think we can say easily that boycott China if it is like that, but it is not like that. Mm. I got from your talk. Thank you very much, sir. And you are listening to Dr. Anurag Tripathi, sir, and he's an expert from international relationship, and it was a very blushing talk. He has brushed up our ideas, and those who are having a superficial knowledge that we should boycott China or else, you can see how he has explained that this is not the way the international things are dealt with. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, Dr.
Thank you, sir. Party,
sir. You are welcome again, and I seek for same cooperation for future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Now we'll move to our next session. Yes, the next talk is from Reverend Father Prashant Samuel, sir. He is the principal in St. Francis de Sales Institution, and his topic is going to be on the COVID-19 and need of spiritual wellness. I request Reverend Father Prashant Samuel, sir, to deliver his talk. The screen is over to sir.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. Couple of days back when my friend called me and asked me that, Father, can you give this particular topic? The first thought came to my mind was, well, people are now looking for spiritual wellness, because I think we were running the race. And it's good that we now look, we have some time to introspect and see where we stand. So, dear friends, before I start talking, I would like to read a little passage. It's from my own scripture, that is the Bible. Kindly allow me to read, because it is good that we get some insight out of the little passage that I'm going to read, which is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, from verses 24 to 27. And it says, everyone then who hears these words of mine and act on them will be like a wise man who built his house on rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house. But it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house.
Father Prashant Samuel, sir, am I audible to you?
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah, I am audible.
Audible. Yes, you are not audible, sir. I think there is a network issue from your side.
Is that so then? But I can hear you.
Sir, am I audible to you? Raise your hand, please.
Yes, sure.
Yes, but you are not audible. Try again, please.
Wow, okay. That's good. Hi, Ganvita Suruan. Eight minutes.
Sir, give me a minute. Sir, give me a minute.
Am I audible now? Am I audible?
Sir, hello, sir.
Yes, I think
you are audible, sir. You are audible. So
okay.
Continue, sir. You are audible.
Thank you, thank you. So as I was reading, I'll read the second part again. And everyone who hears these words of mine, but does not act on them, will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. Dear friends, why I chose this particular passage? Because the passage very clearly mentions of a particular person who builds his house on the rock. The rain fell, the floods came, it hit against the walls, but nothing happened. But on the other hand, there is another person who built his house on the sand. A little rain, a little flood, and his house fell down. I think when it comes to the spirituality part, it is something like that. Unless we have a well spiritual life, I suppose the house will immediately fall down if any calamity, any problem, any situation comes. Today, what we see, especially, I would like to talk in the context of our own country. Every day we hear some sad news. Recently, we heard about an actor also. When we look at this situation, when we look around, what is it?